Till yesterday's class, we have learned lot of concepts. We have defined force. We have also understood complete characterization of a force. Then we defined something called as moment of a force. Then we defined something called as moment of couple of forces or couple moment. We agreed that we are not going to use word torque anymore. We will be either using a word moment of a force or moment of couple of forces. Are you with me till this point, Devan?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now let us proceed. Today we are going to discuss what is rigid body. Can you tell me what, in your understanding, what do you mean by a rigid body? Devan?
The body which does not change its shape.
Okay, so I will add some points to this and we will clearly understand what a rigid body is. So under action of any number of forces, so there may be any number of forces having any magnitude and any direction. Are you with me? So let us say there are F1, F2 up to Fn. These are the forces acting on the body. This n can be anything. So under the action of any number of forces of any which are directed randomly and their magnitude can go up to infinity. Magnitude of any of the force can go up to infinity. Under this, if the body does not change shape and size, not only shape, shape as well as size, if both remain unchanged, then we call that body as rigid body. Are you with me, Devan?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we have clearly defined the rigid body under action of any number of forces having any magnitude and random directions. If the body does not change its shape and size, then we call it as rigid body. Let us look at this definition in another perspective. Let us say I pick up any two random points on the body. These points A and B are randomly chosen points on the body. And let us say distance between these two points is L. And then this body is subjected to n number of forces. N can be anything, having any direction and any magnitude. Under the action of all these forces, if the distance between point A and point B, which are randomly chosen on the body, remains unchanged, and if this is true for any pair of points on the body, then we call the body as rigid body. Are you with me, Devan?
Yes, sir.
This is another perspective of looking at definition of rigid body. Now, any body that you consider is definitely not going to be rigid. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Even if you consider the strongest material on the earth, under the action of some force, it is going to exhibit at least small amount of shape and size change. Therefore, any body under consideration in general is not going to be rigid. But if the deformations of the body within certain range of forces is very small, then we can idealize that body as a rigid body in the prescribed range of magnitude of forces. Are you with me, Devan?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now let us have, once we define what a rigid body is, now let us have a look at what do we understand by transmissibility of a force. So let us consider this body which is a rigid one. So I am considering now rigid body. So in this course of mechanics, this being the introductory course, we are going to deal with the bodies which are idealized as rigid. Are you with me? Or under the action of forces that they are subjected to, their deformation is going to be very small. And therefore, we are going to idealize all the bodies as rigid bodies in this introductory course of mechanics. Given that, now let us say this is point A on a rigid body and it is acted upon by force P. Are you with me? What is its effect on the various points on this body? Tell me. So if I consider any other point B on this body, what is the effect of this force? It will experience P as it is plus a moment. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
So in yesterday's class, we saw that at any other point, you are going to have twofold effects of this force P. One is the force as it is, plus another is moment due to that force. If you choose, pick a point, any point lying on this line, then the effect is only P. Do you agree with me?
Yes.
So therefore, what we mean to say is, if the body is rigid, I can translate this force P anywhere along this line of action of this force, and still all the points on the body are going to have same effect. Are you with me? Dekho, anywhere if I translate this P, so instead of acting this P at A, if I say that let me consider this P to be acting at C, which lies on the line of action of force P, then this force P is going to have exactly the same effect on all points of the body as that P being at A had. Do you agree with me? This principle is called as transmissibility of the force. I want you to give attention on one point here. Dekho, at P, at A, what is the sense of P? Tell me, Devan, is it pushing or pulling?
Pushing.
Yes. And at C, what is the sense of P?
Pulling.
Pulling. But as this is a rigid body, whether the force pushes the body or pulls the body is immaterial. Because as I said, under the action of any number of forces of any magnitude and any direction, the body is not going to exhibit change in size and shape. So it doesn't matter whether the force is pulling or pushing. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
So therefore, in rigid body, as I said, some of the descriptors of force can be waived. For example, we are not really concerned about the sense of the force when we are talking about rigid body. Because anyway, under the action of any force in any direction of any magnitude, the body is not going to change the shape and size. I hope I have made my point clear. Are you with me? Devin?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So Devin, now you can mute yourself. I want now Shardul to unmute himself. Shardul, PRN number 671. Shardul, can you unmute yourself? Yes. So as I said, if we are considering a rigid body and let us say force P is acting at A, then on all the points along the line of action of force, this force is going to have only translationary tendency, or it is going to have the effect in terms of translation of the body. Do you agree with me? There won't be any rotation. There won't be any movement. Do you agree?
Yes, sir.
But if you consider any other point on the body like B, then effect of this force P is going to be the force P as it is plus moment. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
How do you find out moment at B? You drop a perpendicular from B on line of action of force. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
And let us say that perpendicular distance is D, then P into D is going to be the moment at B. Happy?
Yes, sir.
Now, imagine that instead of applying this force P at A, if I apply force P at C, pulling in nature, at A it is pushing. But even if I apply force P at C, which is pulling in nature, is its effect at point B going to change? Does its effect at point B change?
No, sir.
No, because this perpendicular distance is not going to change, and this force P is going to be as it is there, except for the fact that instead of pushing, now it will be pulling. But as I said, as this is a rigid body, we are not worried about whether the force is pushing or pulling at a point of application, because rigid body does not change its shape and size under the action of any number of forces of any magnitudes and any direction. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So here is my argument. If I put this P anywhere along the line of action of this force on the body and of any nature, pulling or pushing, it is going to exhibit exactly the same effect on all points of the body. Happy?
Yes, sir.
This is called as transmissibility of the force. The force can be translated along the line of action on the body without changing its effect on any of the points on the body. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
This is the statement of transmissibility of force. So what is the statement? I will repeat it. Of course, you are going to get it in any of the books, but I am not going to dictate or write down here. But you have to understand, what is transmissibility of a force? You can translate any force on the body along its line of action on the body without changing its effect on any of the points on the body. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What does it physically mean? So it is immaterial whether I show this force acting at A or whether this force or the force acting at C. It is going to have same effect on all points of body. That is its practical meaning. Statements may be clumsy, but physical understanding is easy. You can slide this force along this line of action and consider it acting along any point along the line of action. You still get the same effect on all points of the body. This is transmissibility of the force. So we have given enough time for transmissibility of the force. Now let us go to the next concept in line, and that is particle idealization of bodies. Particle idealization of bodies. Are you with me, Siddharth?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So what is particle idealization of a body? That means the body as shown here, the body that exhibits certain shape and size, I am going to shrink it to a point and I am going to represent the body as that point. Are you with me? For example, let me consider I have a body of shape something like this here. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
And it is acted upon by n number of forces. I am going to disregard its shape and size, and I am going to convert it into a particle idealization. I will assume that this body can be represented by a point, and that is called as particle idealization. Now, under what conditions can we idealize the body as a particle is the question to be answered. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So look at the conditions that must be followed. All forces acting on the body are acting in such a fashion that their line of action must pass through a single point. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
If this condition is satisfied, such that their line of action passes through a single point, all the forces, this body may be acted upon by hundreds of forces, but even if 99 forces have their lines of actions passing through a single point and the 100th one doesn't have its line of action passing through the point, we cannot idealize the body as particle. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So what is the definite one? What is the condition when we can idealize the body as a particle? Only and only when all the forces acting on the body have their lines of actions passing through a point. Happy?
Yes, sir.
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, that point must be the center of mass of that body only, na?
No, not necessarily.
Why?
Why should it be? I will ask you the reverse question. Why should it be center of mass?
Because instead of what we used to do in that 11th classes, instead of considering the whole body, we used to consider the center of mass of that body in order to actually do all the calculations. So, sir, even also in this case, can't we just say that all of the if I'm actually considering a point for this body, then that point would be only considered as center of mass only, where all of the forces would be showing its effect.
Not always necessary, Amrit, I guess.
So to counteract means to give you a counter example. Let me consider this case. Let us say this is a scale. Are you with me? By the way, who asked the question?
Sir, Amit.
Amit. Okay. So, Amit, now let us consider this is the scale and it is acted upon by this force. This force. Yes, and sir. Let us say this. Are you with me?
Yes, sir. Yes.
And it is made up of a material in such a fashion that, okay, I will come to that point little later. Now, can you tell me, if I extend these forces, is it possible that their line of action will meet in a point? Let us say it is possible. These forces are in such a fashion that their lines of actions meet in a single point. Are you with me, Amit? Are you with me? And now, this scale has such a weird material, or it is made up in such a fashion that, or let us extend its length such that even its weight, which acts through its center of gravity. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
That W weight, that also passes through this point. Happy?
Okay, yeah.
Now the question is, which will be the point that you will idealize the body as? Tell me now.
At this point, actually all of the forces are showing their effect.
Yes. So this point may or may not lie on the body is our understanding. Do you agree with me? So it is absolutely not necessary that you will assume that the body, that point which is idealized as a particle representation of body, coincides with its center of mass, center of gravity, or even centroid. Are you with me?
Okay, sir. Yeah, got that.
Sir, I wanted to ask one thing. Yes. Adding on this, that like when we are a particle idealizing the bodies, can we say that if the net torque of the body, means the rotating forces, are zero, means only the forces which are there, it's only causing translational motion, only then we can use particle idealization, otherwise it won't be possible, right?
Yes, you are absolutely right. So you have to hold your horses, because I did not complete the definition of particle idealization.
My bad.
No, it's all right. Perfectly all right. I'm very happy that you have understood that point even before I uttered it. It's all right. So one of the conditions that we have to satisfy is lines of actions of all the forces acting on the body must pass through a single point. Then I can consider the body as a particle. That's what I said. That is the first condition. Are all of you with me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, now Siddharth, let us go ahead. Now, why do this first condition should come in place? The answer is intransmissibility of the force. Do you understand? When there are multiple forces acting on the body at different points of application, still I can consider all of them to be acting only at the point of intersection of their lines of actions because of transmissibility of force. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
I can translate, or I can slide all these forces along their lines of actions, and I can consider them acting only at one point. And in that case, I need not worry about other points on the body. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
So this is the place, or this is the concept, transmissibility of force, from where the first condition required for particle idealization of body does arise. Now, let us go to the second condition. As somebody has already pointed out, when you are idealizing a body as a particle, can you tell me what is the length of particle? Siddharth?
It's in nanometer.
No, it's zero. Particle is a point, so its length is zero. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Our length tends to zero. Now its width is also zero, and its thickness also is zero. If you have an object whose length, width, and thickness is zero, there is no notion of perpendicular distance of a point from line of action of force. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
And in the other perspective, as lines of actions of all the forces are going to pass through a single point, they cannot produce moment about that point. Do you agree with me? We have already seen that a force cannot produce moment about all the points lying on the line of action of force. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Why? Because if I consider any point on line of action of force, its perpendicular distance from the line of action of force is zero, because it is lying on the line of action of force. Therefore, it cannot produce moment. So another, you can take it as a condition, or you can consider that it is the consequence of the first point itself, that the moment I say lines of actions of forces acting on the body, they do pass through a single point for particle idealization, immediately the next point will come is that, therefore, the moment acting on moment acting at that point is non-existent. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
So there is no moment acting here. So when these two conditions are satisfied, in fact, when first condition is satisfied, automatically second condition gets satisfied. Therefore, when all the forces acting on the body have their lines of actions intersecting at a single point, its corollary is that the point is not going to be subjected to any moment. And then we can idealize a body as a particle. Happy?
Yes, sir.
So we have talked about three concepts today. One is the concept of rigid body. Second is the concept of transmissibility of the force, and based on the transmissibility of the force and the concept of moment of a force, we have also understood the necessary and sufficient conditions required for a body to be idealized as a particle. Of course, all this we are dealing, or all this we are defining in context of statics. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
And we have not yet defined two branches of mechanics, that are statics and dynamics. So let me quickly define those here. So I will only define statics for statics now. Dynamics we will define a little later. What is statics? Whenever under the action of n number of forces, the body is at rest and we are studying the effects of forces on the body, then we are dealing with statics. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
It may so happen that the body may be static in one direction, but it may be in under the condition of dynamism in other direction. For example, consider a free fall of an object. The body is static in horizontal direction. Do you agree with me? It is not moving an inch in horizontal direction.
Yes, sir.
But it is not static in vertical direction. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in crude sense, we have defined the statics. As we go along, we will further clarify this. But in statics, when do we idealize body as a particle? When lines of actions of all the forces do pass through a single point. Happy?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let us now go ahead. We are going to deal with the next point in line. And that is, how do we tackle now addition of two forces? Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So how do we tackle the addition? This is the next point that we are going to discuss today. Do you have the answer for it? I'm sure you have. How do you add two forces?
Sir, through vector addition.
Through vector addition. So let us say this is force P bar. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
And this is force Q bar. No, let me consider it. Yes, go ahead.
Sir, are the concepts of statics and dynamics correlated? Means if a person is sitting on earth, the forces acting on him, the G and the normal are on the same point, but he's in no relative motion according to earth, if we see in respect to earth. But yes, for a person in space or on moon, he's in motion.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
So are they means on the point of perspective, what can we say?
Definitely it is a perspective, but there is something more to it. That's why I said I have crudely defined statics. We will come to that little while later when we mature in this course. Are you with me?
Okay.
By the way, who asked the question?
Sir Chaitanya.
Okay, Chaitanya. I'm very happy you asked this question, but we have to wait a little for this answer. Are you with me? But what you are saying is absolutely correct. When I say the body is static on the earth, it is static relative to the earth. I will clarify that point little while later. But crudely, have you understood the definition of statics, or have you understood the conditions for a body to be in static state? Crudely.
Yes, sir. And another question, when we define a particle, when we say idealize a particle, we don't consider the components of force, right? We just consider the original force, or do we consider the components? Because if we consider the components, the definition might not be completely right.
Okay, so what you are trying to say is, if this is the body, and let us say when this force is acting here, 1, 2, and 3. I want all of you to understand this question carefully. So when I, let us say, lines of actions of these three forces, they do meet in this point. Now what he is talking about is, if I resolve these forces in horizontal and vertical direction, for example, if I resolve this force in its two components, one this way and another this way, then their lines of actions are not passing definitely through this point. That's what you are asking, right?
Yes, sir.
So therefore, your question, as it involves resolution of forces, I will delay its answer. We will answer this question only after resolution of forces. Are you with me?
Okay.
So we are going to we are going to learn resolution of forces, and then I will come back to this question. Just remind me at that time. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So shall we move ahead now? Chaitanya?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay. So now, addition of the forces P bar and Q bar is what we are trying to understand now. Now my question to you is, where is the body?
The body is actually that point which on which the forces are actually acting.
Yes. So therefore, when I draw such kind of figures without explicitly showing the body, you have to idealize that. I am sticking to particle idealization. Happy?
Yeah.
So particle idealization means wherever these lines of actions of two forces meet, that is the point where I am idealizing a body. Now, second, next question, how do you add it? So you said it is by vector addition. So can you tell me geometrically or graphically, how should I add these two forces?
Sir, I could explain you a scenario if you allow me to.
Yes, please.
Sir, what really happens is, if I'm actually
No, Amit, your voice is not clear.
Hello?
If you are using earphones, please remove them and then speak.
Okay, sir. Hello. I'm audible right now.
Yes, you are audible.
Considering a body, you know, a circular body, okay, and not a circular body, if I'm just actually considering a point over there, which you had just considered right now, and let any two forces acting over that body be P vector and Q vector, and now, if I'm actually having a kind of a definite direction as X direction, okay, that's originating from that particular point only, where actually both of these forces were showing its effect, okay, and now, if I would just draw two lines parallel to that of the P vector and Q vector, okay. So finally, what we would want to find is that the point, that diagonal of that parallelogram, which would gonna form, that would gonna be the final addition of those two vectors, P vector and Q vector.
This is
and the length of that vector.
Yeah, go ahead.
And that diagonal would be definitely along that X direction only, and the length of that vector and the length of the diagonal of that parallelogram, that would be actually acceleration along with that X direction.
Very good. So this is what you are saying?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So what we have to do is, we have to arrange these two vectors. We have to slide them in such a fashion that tails of both the vectors, they join at a point and then complete the parallelogram. The diagonal of the parallelogram represents the addition of two forces. This is called as parallelogram law of addition. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay. Now, Siddharth, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now, there is a corollary to this parallelogram law. First, I am going to show that corollary as well, and that is triangle law of addition. Are all of you aware of triangle law of addition?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So, yes, sir. For example, this is P bar and this is Q bar. I am redrawing the parallelogram here now, P bar and Q bar. If I complete this parallelogram, now Q bar ko hi ye side parallel hai. So I shift Q bar here. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
And if I consider this triangle, then P bar plus Q bar tip to tail fashion, and in reverse fashion, if I complete the triangle, I get the R bar, which is addition of P bar plus Q bar. So either a triangle law or parallelogram law is accepted as addition of forces. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
A triangle law is corollary of parallelogram law. Then you can, if you have more than two forces, you have a trapezoid law, which is the corollary of parallelogram law itself. So basic law of addition of two forces or addition of n number of forces is completing parallelograms. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Now I am going to ask you the interesting question. These were all details that you know in 11th and 12th. My question is, why do you believe parallelogram law of addition of two forces? For example, let me put my question in slightly different way. Let us say this is P bar. Are you with me, Siddharth?
Yes, sir.
And let us say this is Q bar. Happy?
Yes, sir.
So P bar and Q bar, these are the forces acting on a body which is idealized as a particle. Do you agree that completing the parallelogram law from these forces is a geometrical construction?
Yes, sir.
Now I will choose another geometric construction. For example, I will consider this point as origin, this as radius, and I will draw a circle. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Now I will consider this point as origin, this length of Q bar as Q bar as the radius, and I will draw a circle. These two eventually are going to, let us say, okay, let me draw it in better fashion. Let us say these two circles meet here. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
And I will join this point and I will define this as the addition of P bar and Q bar. Why not? If you believe one geometric construction, you should believe any other geometric construction that I tell you. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Do you understand my question and do you understand the argument what I am trying to make?
Yes, sir.
Somebody said you that vectors do get added up by parallelogram law and you believed. Why?
But sir, in the figure you just drew, it won't meet, right? Because if we don't assume P and Q as same, because P and Q are a different length, then a different length radius circles will be there. Yeah, then why would they even intersect then?
Yes, you are right. So that argument is flawed, agreed. But if I give you any other construction, other form of construction, geometric construction to add this, will it be acceptable as a parallelogram, as you accepted parallelogram? For example, let us say this is P bar. Let us say this is Q bar. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
And now I draw a line parallel to Q bar here. And I draw a line which makes an angle of 10 degrees here. Happy? Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
And then I draw a line parallel to P bar here. Happy? And I draw a line which makes angle of 10 degrees to Q bar or 20 degrees to Q bar. This is 20 degrees. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
And I make these two lines to intersect arbitrarily. This is also a geometric construction. Would you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Now, there are other ways of doing it. Let us say this is P bar. I draw its perpendicular bisector. And this is Q bar. I draw its perpendicular bisector. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Wherever these perpendicular bisectors meet, I join this point with the origin. And I call that as R bar. This is also a geometrical construction. Agreed?
Yes, sir.
My question is, why do you accept one kind of geometrical construction, which is parallelogram, and not the other? Am I very clear in my argument?
Because sir, in parallelogram idea, we can actually verify it.
How?
Mathematically also, and because we can even prove, because vectors, these are just a pictorial representation, right? Because these actually contain numbers.
Who said that? Mm-hmm. Axiom. Who said something about an axiom?
Sir, Amit.
What is your name?
Amit.
Amit, yes. And what exactly is the axiom?
that, we could just add the two vectors, you know, by the vector parallelogram law. We just don't really have the proof for it. We don't have the mathematical proof for it as per Utkarsh. So I don't think that.
No, but what I was asking is the values of, because what Sir did was randomly choosing 10 degrees and 20 degrees, right? We can verify the length because why? If we take resolutions of the vector and see the overall length.
No. Just a minute. When you take a resolution of a vector, in fact, you are using rectangular components, which is also a corollary of parallelogram law.
No, but I'm taking components, I'm using trigonometry right here, because when you define it like whatever, one I cap plus two J cap, what I'm saying is it's 1 degree, 1 unit in x-axis and two unit in y-axis.
No, but the basic question is, why do you think that the physics will follow mathematics? You define something like I cap, J cap and K cap, you define vector addition in mathematics. But do you think the physics should follow mathematics always? So what I was asking the question was, how did the definition of vector come in mathematics, into the place in mathematics? How did we arrive at all those resolution and other concepts? Because we are describing some physical phenomena. Now let me explain it in a better way. Now we are going to perform a thought experiment. Let us say this is a striker. Are you able to imagine that? I am drawing the plan of the striker. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
And now this striker is attached with two strings, one along this P bar and another along this Q bar. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Now I am trying to explain you the origin of parallelogram law, or why we accept mathematically that the vectors do get added by parallelogram law. Uska origin explain karne ki koshish kar raha hu. Are you with me?
Yes,
the mathematics of vector was not derived before the physical observations were taken. The mathematics is derived, mathematical vector definition of vectorial addition has been derived using the observations on physics. How? Now look at this. If this is force P bar, are you with me? Acting on the striker. Now let us consider only one force acting on the striker at a time. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
This is the force P that is acting on the striker. There is no frictional force. Let us assume that the striker, the frictional force is totally nullified by some lubrication between the surface. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
See, the only force, and let us say the striker is massless or it is having very less mass. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
And it is acted upon by force P. Now, Can you observe by how much amount you pulled the object? Aap observe kar sakte ho kya? Nahi. Do you agree with me? Can you observe it?
No, sir. We can't
observe. What can you observe? You can observe under the action of this single force acting on a body, how does body move? Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
So what are
you can observe the displacement.
Yes. So what are the quantities that you can observe? You can observe the instance of time. Let me call this as time t equal to 0. Then as time progresses, the striker is going to move in the direction of P. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Is it observable? Yes. Can you observe the velocity of this striker at various instances of time? Yes, we have speed guns now. We have different techniques by which you can observe the velocity at every instant of time. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
So you can observe the velocity. The next question that I'm going to ask you, if you can observe the velocity, can you also observe its acceleration? From velocities at different instants of time, can you calculate the acceleration?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
That acceleration will also be in the direction of P. Do you agree with me? You
yes,
can
sir.
Perform the experiment and verify. It will be in the direction of P. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what we can measure or observe is this velocity V, acceleration A, and a small mass of this body M. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Now, what does Newton's second law say? Tell me. How this mass and this acceleration is related?
Force equal to mass into acceleration.
Unbalanced force in this direction is P. This must be equal to mass into acceleration. So can you estimate P by using Newton's second law?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, again, why do you believe Newton's second law? Again, it is experimentally proven. We will go to that little while later. But let us assume that Newton's second law holds good. And then, can you find out P? Can you estimate P? Yes. Now, once you estimate the value, this value of P, the next question that I am going to ask is, can you plot this P on the paper by some scale? The answer is yes. Let us say P is 10 Newton and your scale is 1 Newton equal to 1 centimeter. So you already know this direction in which the object is moving. So you know line of action of P. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
And can you, with scale, plot this P on paper? It can be plotted. Happy?
Yes. Yes, sir.
So I have plotted this P on the paper. Now, let us say only Q bar is acting on the striker. Where would have striker gone under the action of Q bar? It will move along the line of action of Q bar. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, can you measure the velocity in that case? Yes. Can you measure the acceleration along line of action of Q bar in that case? Yes. So can you estimate Q bar? Yes.
Yes, sir.
So can I now plot this Q bar on the paper by scale?
Yes, sir.
So let me call this as P bar. By scale, I have drawn P bar, as well as I can draw by scale Q bar on the paper. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Now, when these two forces are acting together, now listen carefully what I am trying to say. When these two forces are acting together, is striker simultaneously going to move along line of action of P and line of action of Q, or is it going to move along some different line?
Sir, some different line.
It cannot move naturally along two lines simultaneously. So it has to move along some other line. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
And can this motion be observable? I apply P and Q both simultaneously. Can I observe the line along which this striker moves?
Yes, sir.
Are you with me? Can I observe its angle with reference to Q?
Yes, sir.
So I can observe angle theta of that line with reference to Q, and I can also observe by how much velocity does it move. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
And I can as well observe, what is the acceleration along this direction. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
I already know the mass of this object. Agreed?
Yes, sir.
So can I take the product mass into acceleration? And can I say, instead of applying P bar and Q bar separately, agar maine M into A itne amount ka force is line ke along lagaya hota, it would have same effect on the striker. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
देखो आर्ग्यूमेंट क्या है. अंडर द एक्शन ऑफ पी बार एंड क्यू बार नेचुरली द स्ट्राइकर इज नॉट गोइंग टू मूव अलोंग टू लाइंस ऑफ एक्शन साइमल्टेनियसली. इट इज गोइंग टू मूव अलोंग अ कॉमन अलोंग अनदर लाइन. आई कैन ऑब्जर्व द एंगल मेड बाय दैट लाइन अलोंग व्हिच स्ट्राइकर मूव्स अंडर द एक्शन ऑफ पी बार एंड क्यू बार विद रेफरेंस टू क्यू बार. आई कॉल दैट एंगल एज थीटा. दैट इज मेजरेबल. आई कैन एज वेल मेजर द वेलोसिटी ऑफ द स्ट्राइकर एज इट मूव्स अलोंग दिस लाइन. And therefore, I can estimate the acceleration. I will multiply it by mass. And I will say, instead of P bar and Q bar acting together, if I apply force of magnitude R equal to MA along this line, it is going to have same effect on the body. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, dekho, maine parallelogram wagaira kuch complete nahi kiya hai. I now know the magnitude of this force. I know this angle theta. Can I geometrically draw this to scale here?
Yes, sir.
So geometrically draw kiya theta, and then magnitude R. And to my surprise, this R lies exactly at the location along diagonal of the parallelogram completed. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
And therefore, now I say R bar is equal to the additive effect of P bar and Q bar. So if I replace P bar and Q bar only by R bar, it is going to give me the same effect, and that R bar can be obtained by completing the parallelogram. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
These are experimental observations. If I give you a system which has highest RAM in the world and highest processing speed, and if I ask you to sit in a laboratory for full night, and I ask you to derive why the striker did move along this line in first place, you will not be able to answer that. There is no proof for that. Are you with me? There is no analytical mathematical proof. There is only experimental observation that you can make. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Such kind of statements, we call them as axioms of mechanics, which are experimentally verifiable, but they do not have any analytical and mathematical proof. In fact, entire vector mechanics or vector mathematics, resolution and whatnot, everything is derived based on understanding that there are some quantities which get added up like parallelogram. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So all other quantities, they which follow this family of addition, for example, if I consider velocity v1 and v2 directed along p bar and q bar, let us say the object is v1 bar and v2 bar, then the resultant velocity follows this parallelogram law is the experimental observation. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So therefore, vector mechanics and its mathematics वो सब बाद में डिराइव हुआ बेस्ड ऑन द फैक्ट दैट ऑल द क्वांटिटीज दैट गेट एडेड अप बाय पैरेललोग्राम लॉ वी आर गोइंग टू कॉल देम एज वेक्टर्स आर यू विद मी
यस सर
सो दिस स्टेटमेंट्स वी कॉल देम एज एक्सियम्स सो लेट मी राइट डाउन दैट सो हाउ मेनी एक्सियम्स डू वी हैव इन मैकेनिक्स सो वी आर नाउ गोइंग टू डील विद द नंबर ऑफ एक्सियम्स दैट वी हैव इन मैकेनिक्स आर यू विद मी
यस सर
So what are the axioms? So as I said, parallelogram law. But before that, all the Newton's three laws, they are axioms. These are the statements which are experimentally verifiable in our universe, but they do not have any mathematical or analytical proof. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So Newton's three laws, 1, 2, and 3, I will write them as Newton's three laws. These are axioms. Now, imagine that you are in some other universe where these statements do not hold good, then you will have to recalibrate your theory. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
For example, when the object approaches the speed of light, all these Newton's laws, they do not hold good. So we had to derive another theory, which is Einstein's relativistic mechanics. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So you don't have to go to another universe. In situations where this basic axioms are questioned or violated experimentally, then we are going to derive a new theory. You cannot use this Newtonian mechanics. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Chalo. What is the fourth axiom? As I said, fourth axiom is law of parallelogram law. Parallelogram law of addition of forces. So triangle law and trapezoid law being corollaries of parallelogram law, they fall under the same category. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So parallelogram law of addition of forces is the another axiom that we believe because it is experimentally observable. Now, what is the next axiom? Law of gravitation. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So what is law of gravitation? If there are two masses m1 and m2, point masses, that means masses which are idealized as particles in space, and r is the distance between them, then the gravitational force between them is proportional to product of their masses and inversely proportional to square of distance between them. Do you agree with me? This is law of gravitation. Why do you believe law of gravitation? Because it is experimentally observable, but you cannot have any proof, means you can't find out analytically why the gravitational force should be proportional to m1 m2 and why it should be inversely proportional to its distance. There is no argument there. It is experimentally observed. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So law of gravitation. So I request you, I am not going to cover this law in the class. You are well aware of that. So I request you to read this law, law of gravitation. And the sixth one, transmissibility of the force. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So these are the basic six. इनमें से कितने इंडिपेंडेंट एक्शन है तो पांच इंडिपेंडेंट है, एक डिपेंडेंट है, बट दीज आर द सेट ऑफ एक्सियम्स ऑन विच द एंटायर मैकेनिक्स इज बेस्ड. आर यू विद मी?
यस सर.
सो वी स्टार्ट फ्रॉम हियर एंड all other principles of mechanics have been derived based on these axioms. If this any one of these axioms is questioned or violated in any situation, we cannot use principles of Newtonian mechanics. Am I very clear?
Yes, sir.
So let us conclude today's class by understanding the addition of two vectors. First of all, let us try to define what do we mean by addition of two vectors. So let us say there are two forces acting on a body, P bar and Q bar. By its addition, I mean I will be removing P bar and Q bar and I will replace it by a single force which produces same effect as pair P bar and Q bar on all points of the body. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
If body is idealized as a particle, then there is no question of other points. But typically, how do I define summation of two forces, P bar plus Q bar acting on a body? I will remove those forces from the body and replace it by a single force which produces same effect on all points of the body. Then I call that as addition of these two forces. This is first the philosophical definition of a addition of two forces. Do you agree with me?
Yes, sir.
This definition goes very close to the definition of resultant. But resultant has something additional. So we will have separate definition for resultant later. Right now we are defining addition of two forces or more forces, P bar and Q bar. So if there are n number of forces acting on a body, how do I add them? So philosophically, what is the addition? I will remove all those forces from the body, replace it by a single force which produces same effect on all points of the body, and I will call that force as the addition of all forces. Happy?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Very close to resultant, but mind you, resultant has something more. Now, how do we actually perform the addition of these forces? As experimentally observable, we perform it by parallelogram law and not any other geometrical construction. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we had another couple of points in today's discussion. We will have to take them in the next class. So what are those points? So I will just state them. So trailer of next class, what are we going to do next? We are now going to talk about resolution of forces. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So it is the operation reverse to addition. Addition is replacing two or more forces by a single force. Resolution is splitting the single force into multiple forces or system of forces which has the same effect as that single force on the body. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Once we do this resolution, we will go back to the question asked. This question. Just remind me there. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
And in this resolution, we are going to see two types of resolutions, rectangular and non-rectangular resolutions. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Rectangular and non-rectangular. So this is coming up. This is in next class. And in the same next class, we are going to start solving the problem. Okay, so let us stop here. If anyone has any doubt, please raise it now. Or you can write down your name and roll number, PRN number in chat box, and you can leave the meeting.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, welcome.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, I'm not able to write my roll number in like the public chat box. It is only going directly to you. Is that fine?
So that is the setting of the meeting. I allow you to only chat with me. So you have to send it.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir.
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, will you provide the book for reference?
Yes, I am just waiting for the decision of the Canvas. If Canvas is not going to be activated in a day or two, I am going to make a Google Classroom where I will share the book.
No, sir, for our you can share it on WhatsApp group, sir.
No, that soft copy of book, its size is little large. I will have to share it on Google Classroom. So I will do it.
Okay.
In couple of days. Yeah.
Thank you.
So I hope everyone has written their name. Now I am concluding the meeting.